In previous lecture, we discussed about communism as a general, its source, development, particularly in Russia, and after Bolshevik revolution in Russia, what are the changes in the system, etc. Now, we have to discuss this with respect to India. In those days, obviously, it was British rule in India. After that Montague-Chelmsford law, then also it is not considered that perfect democracy or democratic system was established over here. Moreover, the English people or England, no doubt it was democratic nation, but still economically we have to consider that as capitalist. And this was not easily in favor of Russia or these communists. Particularly in earlier days only, when British Empire was in a state of formation, particularly after defeating Maratha Empire, they were discussing how this empire is going to end. Ultimately, empire is formed, that means it is having death at one instant. What are the probable causes? And out of that, they discuss one important cause, that was threat from Russia, or like that, power from outside. And particularly when Russia invaded Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, that means Central Asian provinces, this fear was actually becoming true. Particularly, they created a buffer state, that is Afghanistan, in between, and so matter was what we can say postponed. But still, there was threat that Russian expansion can be there. After particularly the First World War, when Russia accepted communism, then onwards the communist are spread out. In India, Manavendranath Roy from Bengal, he was obviously inspired by this communist idea. He attended second communist congress, worldwide communist congress in Russia in 1920s, and obviously he was inspired, but he was not able to return immediately in India. So initially he tried and then escaped to Germany and started out to work from Germany. In India, they started out developing certain centers, particularly in Bombay territory on those days. We are calling that as Comrade Dange. He was the person in interest of communism from Mumbai. In August 1922, Comrade Dange brought out the first weekly, that is named Socialist, from Bombay. This was first communist weekly in India. Then from many provinces, for example Madras province, the name is Singaravelu. Then Calcutta, Muzaffar Ahmad. Lahore, Ghulam Hussein. They were worked. And the question is always that why the young generation, particularly in 1920 to 25, in that particular period, why this young generation was attracted towards communist? Question. Really, we have to think. Particularly, the dissatisfaction was there because of outcome of non-cooperation movement. Before actually starting out this non-cooperation movement, Barrister Jinnah was not in favor of this. As we have discussed in earlier lectures, that he was totally against, because according to him that was not right time to start out movement. So whenever we are discussing about this movement,
we should keep in mind whenever we are starting out movement, you have to think twice, thrice before starting out the movement. Reason is that if movement becomes successful, a small movement should be there. But if that is achieving success, whatever the goal, for what purpose we started that, and then after achieving the success, it is obvious that we are getting more satisfaction and more number of followers we are getting. But one unsuccess, no doubt whether it was all India level or what, but still that unsuccess makes some dissatisfaction, particularly Gandhian politics was not favored by many youth. Now, on guidance of Manvendranath Roy, in India, Communist Party started out their work. Particularly, their face was like that, Workers and Peasants Party. They prepared two levels, one is open, that is declared one, and second, that was closed one, or we can say total secret one. And like that, they started out their work. A small or tiny communist groups were produced all over India. And then, finally, Communist Party of India was founded in 1925. But this was also remarkable from British government. They observed or predicted the chances of Bolshevik legal cover was served by this Workers and Peasants Party, that is called as WPP. For this, ultimately the communist ideas developed in India, and the striking feature was obtained from 1928 onwards, that particularly in 1928 and 1929. Why I am calling striking feature, that that was era of strikes. There were over 203 strikes and lockouts involving 506,851 workers and loss of 3,164,704 working days. Now, this type of activities were also started out developing in India. The mean should be there somewhere. And then the socialist ideas were flourished particularly. Now, no doubt, the certain revolutionist groups were also attracted, because communism and revolution, obviously communists are also revolutionary, particularly they in those days. They were interested to change out the existing situation of the world. So they are also revolutionaries, and with help of revolutionary activities only, they were able to gain government in particularly Russia and later on in many nations. And so the certain revolutionaries like Dadar, they were also get attracted towards communist ideology. Because of that, the Dadar movement has also extended to communist under Ratan Singh, Santokh Singh and Teja Singh Swatantra. Like that, activities of communists were there in India. In 1929, India also observed something, actually not that affected, but Europe was badly affected by that incident. That was worldwide depression was there, the Great Depression. That depression made Hitler to become more popular in Germany. That depression made communist ideology to flourish to greater extent, because entire Europe was facing out problem of that depression. But Russia was not at all facing out the problem of depression, or Russia was able to swallow out that digestion, swallow out that depression, resulting the Russia proved to be, or that Bolshevism or communism proved to be more powerful. And then in India, certain mean is taken by that socialism idea, particularly youth, that Subhash Chandra Bose and Jawaharlal Nehru, both were attracted towards this socialist ideology, that initially variety of student and youth organizations were formed. Now in 1928, Nehru joined hands with Subhash Chandra to organize Independence for India League, to fight for complete independence of India and socialist revision of her economic structure. So this is the change. Particularly in case of Lokmanya Tilak, he was only arguing, obviously in those days that argument was also very, very important. He was arguing that we want Swaraj, that is self-government, or we can say the dominion state. So we were demanding in those days for dominion state at least. But now the generation, it changed, and they demanded complete independence, that is not dominion state. And secondly, they put forward the structure of new India, that should be socialist structure. This is the change particularly. Now, meanwhile, we have to discuss what happened in 1920 onwards again. No doubt, as we have discussed, that Congress is not a single political party. Many other political parties were involved. Like we have discussed, Muslim League, Barrister Jinnah was from Muslim League. But Barrister Jinnah was also attending Congress session. Lokmanya Tilak, he was from Sarvajanik Sabha. He was having complete hold on Sarvajanik Sabha after a few years, and he was involved in Congress. Like that, many individual or different parties were there. Now, particularly because of non-cooperation movement, there was some dissatisfaction. Motilal Nehru, Barrister Chittaranjan Das, N.C. Kelkar decided to fight legally. Now, the politics was concentrated again on Simon Commission. As we discussed, according to Montagu Chelmsford, whatever the amendments were there, provision was there, constitution was made, by bicameral legislature was started out for central government. Then there were elections. But before Simon Commission, we are discussing out that many Indians, groups, apart from Congress, they participated in the election and joined the government. This is very nice thing, that few Indians accepted this policy. And so, now they were having experience of the particularly parliamentary democracy, to some extent obviously, but it was there. Now, when changes are made, we have to take what is the result of that. We have to discuss. For that purpose, Simon Commission was set. But as we are, or in those days also, Indians were saying this way, that what is the impact of this all amendments and practical rule. For that purpose, Indians should be there in the commission. And then no Indian was there on commission, therefore this commission was banned. We opposed this commission, and we welcome with black flags Obviously, Britishers also charged lathi charge and all that, their traditional techniques, resulting there was death of our great leader Lala Lajpat Rai, as we have discussed this all. But the issue was there as it is. What modifications should be there? And then we discussed that Nehru report was set. That was against that statement of Lord Birkenhead that Indians were not able to give any constitution. They can come together and discuss about constitution. But Nehru report is memorable as the first major Indian effort to draft a constitutional framework for the country. So we discuss in history that there was always some administrative system for all over India during Chandragupta's rule, during Ashoka's rule, even Gupta Empire. But now we framed a democratic way constitution. The Nehru report was asking particularly the freedom as dominion state means what? That certain department should be in hands of Britishers only, like defense, foreign, but remaining department should be in hands of Indian, as we had discussed earlier, way that is called as Swaraj or freedom, that is not exact freedom, but we are having some rights like Indian states are having today in the ruling pattern, that central government is having certain rights and state governments is having certain rights. So like that freedom was asked, and actually from British side they should accept whatever the demands. The Nehru report was submitted. We discussed that Jinnah from Muslim League obviously was not satisfied with constitution, but still he suggested his total 14 demands and he gave them separately. Now from 1909 to their 1929, nearly 20 years, a simple demands were put forward again and again. The Muslim League's politics was continuously moving around that separate electorate. Reserve seats, and where Muslims are in minority there we want reservation, where they are in majority we want power. Even they demanded something like reorganization of states should be there, particularly where Muslim dominance is there, particularly in those days Bengal and Punjab. There we should have provision for rule and like that. Anyway, but in latter phase, particularly Nehru report was submitted to government, and now it was government's turn. We gave them, okay, we are now having constitution and that was made by Indian only. Now it's your turn that you should act according to this report and give us the dominion state freedom at least. The Nehru report was given but ultimately Britishers were carrying out no action on it. Meanwhile, another thing was there, Lord Irwin, Viceroy of India, he suggested a congressman that let us wait for Simon Commission's report, and on declaring Simon Commission's report, we can discuss. We can hold a round table conference and we can discuss about the amendments. So it is not the case that we are not discussing with you. So this was the success of whatever the apports given to Simon Commission, and so this was the origin of round table conference. Now Gandhiji also said, all right, before going for round table conference, he asked total four demands. The one that was, Congress must have majority representation. So again and again, the congressmen, they were saying that Congress is only responsible party from India. Particularly, that is gathering of variety of parties. So Congress demanded the total representation. Then roundtable conference should be discuss the details of dominion status. Keep in mind that philosophical discussion should not be there. Only thing is that what are the clauses and in what way dominion status should be there. So are you discussing about that and not on the basic principles? Then the British should accept and act immediately. Now, this type of demands were there. Subhash Chandra Bose refused to sign his Delhi statement, but Jawaharlal Nehru accepted. Ultimately, these all suggestions given by Gandhi that was not accepted by IRWIN. And then it was clear that Congress is having their own way, particularly under presidentship of Jawaharlal Nehru. That was the session in 1929, a Lahore session, most important session from Congress point. The president was young, Jawaharlal Nehru, and he asked, now that almost 1 year is going to complete, we ask for dominion status and British government is not carrying out any move for giving us dominion status, and now we demand Purna Swaraj. Purna Swaraj means total freedom, entire freedom we want. So this way the demand was put forward, one step forward. Now no doubt, not only demand was there, as we are going to get freedom, they decided that 26th January should be considered as Independence Day of India. Every Indian should pledge that now we are free and we are not obeying any British order. We are not bowing in front of British Empire, etc. And then that Indian freedom should be there in reality. Now, obviously, rule making authority, they were Britishers, and so they decided to start out the civil disobedience method. Before starting out this civil disobedience movement by Gandhiji, first he demanded with IRWIN, so different 11 points were there. Like that, 50% cutoff should be there in army expansion, army expenses, sorry. Gandhiji obviously, according to his non-violence principle, must be against army violent. And secondly, Indian army was not used in those days for particularly India. That army was used to solve different international issues. Like that, army was there in Mesopotamia to solve the crisis. Army was there in Europe during First World War. Like that. So, make cut off in 50% in Indian army's expenses and obviously civil services salaries. Then total prohibition or release of political prisoners, reforms of CID department, changes in Arm Act, then lowering rupee sterling exchange rate, then ...50% reduction in land revenue, abolition of salt tax and state's monopoly over salt production. Like that, different 11 points were asked. Now, just consider this issue. Initially, we were demanding, we means in those days Congress, we were demanding dominion status, that is Swaraj, or freedom of colonies. Then it was not given. We demanded for total Swaraj, Purna Swaraj, a total freedom. Obviously, if you are not getting dominion status, who is going to give you total freedom? That was also not there. And then we demanded that reduce of military expenses, make salt tax free, like that demands. That means we changed out our attitude, or maybe possible after giving so high demand, we demanded small things again. And obviously that was also not satisfied. Here we can check that why there was problem in British rule. Obviously, what is my idea? That suppose you are going to get 100 rupees by some way, you can release at least 10-15 rupees for the purpose. So you can earn 95 rupees or 85 rupees easily. But Britishers were not giving that. Even salt was taxed. It was not necessary actually. But in order to overcome their problems, particularly of there was crisis of depression, then there should be strong army and etc. The chances, I'm not saying it was there, because in 1929-1930 Hitler was not in power, but he was active in Germany, and he was again and again saying that if he is going to become ruler by any means, he will not obey the Treaty of Versailles. Then he can attack Poland, Union of Germany, all these things were given. So chances were there that if he is refusing out Treaty of Versailles, then obviously again outbreak of World War can be there in those days. And so Britishers were not allowing or accepting any demands from this, and as a result Gandhiji decided to start out struggle. Again we can check out particularly the Congress activities after Gandhi, Gandhi era, beginning of Gandhi era. We started out first the non-cooperation movement of 1920, then it was taken back, then till 1927 no movement was carried out, then there was Simon boycott. We cannot say that it's constructive movement, like civil disobedience movement. No doubt we were resigning out from government jobs, we were not cooperating, but this was something having mass evokeness, but here that was not there. Whereas 1927 Simon go back, that was just showing the negative character. In between that they carried out something that is called as making use of khadi popular, as we have discussed that G.V. Joshi from Sarvajanik Sabha, Sarvajanik Kaka, he popularized in old days about this khadi, etc. So Gandhiji accepted his and started advertising about this khadi, and obviously it was right. Then the constructive work, that is to protest against alcoholism, like that was carried out particularly. And now in 1930, we started out. That means year to year, almost there is gap of 10 years. And in that 10 years gap, some discussions were obviously there, but Britishers were able to rule peacefully, particularly. Now, in these particular days, Gandhiji now started again a movement that is called as civil disobedience movement. And everywhere in India, this movement started. The credit of this civil disobedience movement that it started all over the India. From particularly Gandhiji carried out a march that is called as Dandi March. From his ashram of Savarkar in Gujarat to Dandi. Somewhere around 380 kilometer distance he walked. And everywhere the Satyagrahis used to meet him, and a mass was moving from one place to another. In those days, how that mass was managed, really questioned. And then he disobeyed the law of salt and obviously was arrested. That was the problem. But at that time, many Satyagrahis were arrested. Where coastal area is there, people tried to disobey, tried to break out these laws. Where jungle was there, tried to establish, tried to disobey the law of jungles. Like that, entire India was moved against with this civil disobedience movement. But Barrister Jinnah managed Muslim League not to participate in this civil disobedience movement. And that's why in this particular civil disobedience movement, you'll find that, I'm again saying, not Muslims, but Muslim League was not introduced anywhere. Whereas the Congress people, those Muslims were there in Congress, they used to participate in that. The Vande Mataram become more popular, particularly in 1920 onwards. Barrister Chittaranjan Das, as we had discussed earlier, Motilal Nehru, Barrister Chittaranjan Das, N.C. Kelkar, all of these leaders from Congress, they established Swarajya Party, and they fought elections and ultimately get elected in whatever that bicameral or according to that Montagu-Chelmsford Act, whatever the government was formed, they constituted over there. Barrister Jinnah was also elected, and then actually he was elected from one reserve seat for Muslims. Initially he was member, but when it was there in particularly Rowlatt Act was passed, at that time he resigned the government, and they rejoined the government after 1923, and then a strong government something was formed, and then Barrister Jinnah demanded a round table conference for discussion about Indian constitution and about dominion status, etc. But obviously this suggestion was refused. Then in latter phase, that day was there now, after starting out civil disobedience movement, Gandhiji was imprisoned, Motilal Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru, all these leaders were also imprisoned. But the civil disobedience movement started and flourished all over India. As we had discussed earlier, that from 1920 to 1930 particularly, no other movement was started. The reason is that after abruptly end of non-cooperation movement by Gandhi in 1922, that was there was a problem that we have discussed that separatist trend, communal rights were there in India, particularly Mopla, Kohat, and then all over India, different areas were under communal rights. And in particular those days, Gandhiji was charged against that same thing as Lokmanya Tilak was charged, that is sedition. And then there was punishment of total 6 years. A simple, we can say, arrest only, but normal arrest was there for 6 years for that purpose. Gandhiji was now imprisoned again in 1922, but he suffered a problem of appendicitis, and therefore some operation was there. After that surgery, he was rescued from the prison. But Gandhiji honestly said that as I was punished for 6 years, till 1922 to 6 years, that means 28, I should not start any movement politically against British government. This type of political leaders are rare in nowadays. But Gandhiji was of that personality, that greatness was there with Gandhiji. And he accepted that no doubt Britishers rescued him early, but he should not enjoy that thing, or he should not fight. He was loyally accepted that. And then after civil disobedience movement, particularly in those days, there was arrangement for round table conference in Britain. Britishers asked this Gandhiji, Nehru, to participate in the round table conference. For that purpose, Jawaharlal Nehru, Motilal Nehru was taken to jail in Yerawada, that is near Pune, as Gandhiji was imprisoned again, and Nehru was also there in prison at Naini. But ultimately Gandhiji decided that we should not participate. Nehru was of that opinion that all over India, civil disobedience movement is flourishing out, spreading out, and in that particularly, why we should stop this movement. And so they were in position to fight. That struggle was continued, and Gandhiji refused to participate in first round table conference. No doubt, Barrister Jinnah was there. He obviously was of that opinion that by right this time Gandhiji is listening all over to Nehru, and that's why he is not participating in the round table conference. So Barrister Jinnah was working in that particular period in that way, that round table conference was organized by himself, and then this round table conference was held in London. Now, in that particular roundtable conference, they demanded some separatist trade. Now, this was held in 15 January 1931, whereas the election, session of Muslim League was there in 29 December 1930. Barrister Jinnah was not present. He was there in London. But barrister and later on famous poet Muhammad Iqbal was president of this Muslim League session held in Lahore. You are aware of Muhammad Iqbal? If not, I must inform you that whatever the famous patriotic song is there in India, that Urdu famous patriotic song, Sare Jahan Se Achha, it's all Indians are today also singing with great patriotism. This song was of Muhammad Iqbal, Sare Jahan Se Achha, Hindosta Hamara. Try to recollect last lines if you are aware of Urdu or Hindi then you can able to understand easily mazhab. Mazhab means religion. Mazhab nahi sikhata. Apas mein bair rakhna. That means religion is not teaching any animity. And Hindi hai hum, we are all Indians. Watan hai Hindosta hamara. What is our nation? That is Hindosta, that is India in Urdu. And now this famous poet was president of Muslim League in 1930. He was very great personality. He was barrister from England. Then he learned at Heidelberg, Munich, Cambridge. He was member of Legislative Council of Punjab. And 1908 onwards, he was associated with Muslim League. And he put forward a concept of the famous theory, that is dual nations theory here. He said that no doubt the Muslims and Hindus were staying together for so many years. But still, Muslims must consider as separate nation in India. Now, he said that religion is actually considered as personal level in European countries, not in Islam. In Islamic concept, religion and state are associated only. And therefore, we are not able to give or get any success for religious unity, particularly in India. Whatever the observations are there, they are not of any good sense. And according to me means not my, according to Muhammad Iqbal, Indian Muslims must have complete right for their own development on basis of their religion. The democratic principles of Europe, we should not apply to India, because here India is divided into different castes, religions, and therefore we demand separate Muslim nation in India. Ultimately, he mapped out what should be that separate Indian nation. That is present Pakistan, that is Punjab, Northwest Frontier Region, Sindh Territory and Balochistan. These territories should be fused together, and then this Northwest state, then it may be Dominion state or entirely freed from Britain. There is no question, but Muslims must have their separate nation. This type of great thinking was there in Muslim League's session of 1930. And then the Muslim leaders sent message to Jinnah that we have to follow these principles. Obviously, Jinnah was also shocked, and he decided that not to return India immediately. He prefers to stay in London for many years after that. Now, after that first roundtable conference, the conclusion is that there should be separation of central government and provinces, and the responsibility should be handed over both at central province, central government as well as provinces. In this transaction, it's government's role to protect out minorities. Then British government is going to reserve some rights in this transition, particularly so that in India, there should be developed some responsible ruling system. Particularly in central government, there should be a government in form of union of states, and that should have both the territories in British India as well as princely state. Now here we have to discuss about what is that princely state matter. Try to recollect. Now I am showing this way. This is map of India, suppose. So this entire India, suppose I am showing in pie chart. This entire India was not under British dominance. Say this territory was ruled by British directly. Then this all territory was there in hands of local chief or kings in those days, those who accepted British suzerainty either by accepting that famous system, subsidiary alliance. Later on, they accepted British dominations. And obviously, Lord Dalhousie with his famous lapse policy. But he was also not able to merge out these princely states in India or British India. You are aware that Jammu Kashmir, originally that was in the hands of Sikhs or Raja Ranjit Singh. Then onwards, after defeat of Dalip Singh by Britishers, they sold out to Gulab Singh by certain agreement, and then that was there in hands of Gulab Singh. So there was rule that was indirect rule of British government. In Maharashtra, the basic thing that emperor, Maratha Empire, was having capital at Satara, that was lost because of lapse policy of Dalhousie. But Kolhapur, that was persisted for longer time, the second throne of Maratha Empire, that was persisted. Here direct rule of Britishers was not there, that was indirect rule. Then another famous state, that was Hyderabad, the Nizam. Nizam-ul-Mulk, originally he was appointed by Aurangzeb or Mughal Emperor, and later on, he declared freedom and ultimately accepted British suzerainty, as we discussed earlier, Junagadh in Gujarat, and like that so many princely states were there, and the matter was concentrated on that princely state also, because entire India was not directly ruled by Britishers. And so whenever this type of arrangements we have to make, what should be relationship between these provinces and princely state. Now, next, that after establishment of central legislature, the council of ministers that is going to be responsible for that. But the defense and foreign policies should be in hands of Governor General or Viceroy particularly. Certain supreme power should be there in hands of governors in order to protect their territories. The important thing, that is treasury. And they decided that by applying certain protective measures, the treasury should be handed over in the Council of Ministers. But in order to carry out this, we should meet again in second round table conference. So virtually, this plan was looking good. I hope this is carrot, and I must run behind that. Very nice carrot was presented by Britishers. Obviously, when second round table conference is there, there should be participation of Congress. And then, Viceroy Irwin, a gentleman, religious attitude was there for Irwin. He accepted that one should participate Congress, and for that purpose he rescued Mahatma Gandhi from Yerawada jail without any condition. And then he called him for discussion in Delhi. And then that great Viceroy, whatever the residency was there, Gandhiji went there. Churchill felt annoyed for that. He said, originally Gandhiji was advocate, then he was having charge on sedition, and so-called half-naked fakir in the Eastern world, he is now entering in Viceroy Palace. It's really, and he is going to talk with Viceroy, British Viceroy, the representative of Emperor. He was talking at equality level. Really shameful for Britishers. Like that statements were given by Churchill. No doubt he was an opposition in those days, and therefore that was not having any problem for Gandhiji. Then the discussion was started from 17 February 31. Total 8 sessions were there, and then pact was signed on 5th March 1931. There Gandhiji accepted to pause, keep in mind, not to stop, but to pause this movement of civil disobedience. Then he accepted to visit England for this roundtable conference, but he asked British Viceroy to give complete concessions, or simply we can say removal of tax on salt. And there should be right for satyagrahis to perform their satyagraha. And ultimately, this all, whatever the demands, they were accepted by Viceroy. This is first time in history that Britishers were talking with any Indian leader on that equality status. And that's why this Gandhi-Irwin pact proved to be important. After discussion, the journalist asked Gandhiji, how was the discussion? And Gandhiji said, very nice. That discussion was very nice, and both of us, both means Lord Irwin and Gandhi, laughed at Churchill about his statement particularly. Viceroy drank tea, whereas I drank plain lemon water, and I added a pinch of salt that was prepared by myself, by breaking law of salt. That was the most important thing. Just for lifting out a salt, Gandhiji was imprisoned, And now in front of Viceroy, he was using his own salt, made salt. Now, here one important thing was there. While these all discussions was going on in a very nice manner, actually we had to discuss this part, that revolutionarist activities, again we had to discuss. But here the reference is that our great revolutionarist Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev were just to be hanged out. They were having punishment at hang till death. And it was possible for Gandhiji. It is said like that, that it was possible for Gandhiji to argue this way, that one can stop this punishment. Actually, Bhagat Singh carried out bomb blast in assembly. But that was not intended to kill any person. But Britishers decided to do that, and ultimately he was charged with different issues, and the punishment was declared. At that time, actually, many people argued this way, that it was possible for Gandhiji, as he was talking on equality level, it was quite possible for him to stop this, but he was not able to do so, or he was not intended to do so. But fact is that at that time Gandhiji asked Lord Irwin to do that thing, but Irwin said that when we are implementing law, I should not disturb the procedure, I should not disturb that all law or legal procedure, and therefore it is not in my hands to save Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev. Gandhiji immediately asked, alright, that means it is not in your hands, but at least can I tell our people that I have requested you for this, but you showed your problem and accepted that it is not possible for you. Irwin immediately replied, yes, I don't have any objection, but you must explain to your followers that I was not having any chance rather than refuse in this case. This is the argumentation particularly Gandhiji tried. But again, question is there. If Viceroy of India is not in position, he is not having right to stop this hangout, then who was having rights? Or this is called as, one can say, rule of law, I don't know. But when Gandhiji went to Karachi, that was session of Congress was there held in Karachi 1931. He was also welcomed with black flags, and the youth movement was active, particularly Subhash Chandra Bose laid out his all, and his black flags were there for the purpose that Gandhiji was not able to save life of Bhagat Singh. Now, the session was held in month of March. Earlier way Congress sessions were held in December, but December is month of winter, and Congress sessions used usually in ground, open ground, and that was problematic. So 1931 onwards the change was there, they decided to held session in month of March. Then this Gandhi-Irwin pact was discussed in this session, and ultimately they appointed Mahatma Gandhi as sole person responsible for roundtable conference. And according to this, Gandhiji went in England or round table conference. But here the problem was different. We are discussing this.